Welcome back to our discussion. We're now continuing to study the doctrine of sin, or hamartiology. And hamartiology is the doctrine of sin. Okay? And that's what we're looking at. And we left off the last time talking about that sin may not be or may be involuntarily committed, if you recall. This is where we left off in the last class. Now I want to begin to look at what is the basic nature of all sin. What is the basic nature of all sin? Well, sin is basically selfishness. In the most simple of terms, sin is basically selfishness. Okay? Sin is the choice of self as the supreme end. So let's break this down in two sections here, okay? Let's go. We're going to do this. So I'm going to give this. So we're answering. This is the basic definition of sin, okay? So let's do this. We're going to do an A, okay? We're going to do an A, and here's what we're going to do. We're going to put that sin is the choice of self as the supreme end. Okay. Sin is the choice of self as the supreme end. Sin is always going to seek its own. That's why it's selfishness. Excuse me. Sin is all about me and nothing about you. Sin, then, by definition, sin is the opposite. Right? Sin is going to be the opposite, right, of the supreme Let's say sin is the opposite of the supreme love of God. I think when we put in terms like this, people are able to comprehend this doctrine of hamartiology, which is sin. They can understand it. Right? When most people sin, because we live in a very narcissistic world, and since a lot of people are in that narcissism, right, then it almost seems like it's normal. But when you begin to put it in simpler terms that are obvious truths, then they can begin to comprehend it. And this is where we struggle the most, because some things are not so obvious. So here what I want you to look at is that sin is a choice. That's the other thing. Sin is the choice. Sin is the choice, and I want you to understand that, okay? Everything about sin, I want you to understand this, okay? Everything about sin, okay, revolves around this word here, choice. Now, you have choices to make, okay? And those choices that you make, okay, have consequences. But you do make the decision. Even if someone puts a gun to your head and tells you to do something, you still make the choice. You have chosen to save your life physically to commit a sin. Even if they put the gun to your head, you have made the choice. Now, you may want to justify your choice. You may want to explain your choice. But you cannot undo the choice that you made. And inherent in the choice is consequences, right? So I want you to understand that. Inherent in choice is consequences. That's the relationship that we're always going to be faced with. That when there is a choice, there's always going to be a consequence. Now, you don't have to like the consequences. But neither can you deter the consequences. Consequences can be deterred only by the mercy of God. We have two concepts here that I want you to understand when it comes to the relationship that man has with God. First of all, we have a thing called grace. Grace is something that God gives to the person who does not deserve. Mercy is the second item. Mercy is that you do not receive what you do deserve. So you must always understand, you cannot determine when grace is going to be applied on the part of God toward man, and neither can you determine when mercy, the mercy of God, is going to be applied by God toward man. You are not the determining factor. God is. For that reason, you cannot compare your situation with someone else. Because if you are capable, if you have the authority and the ability to do what I just mentioned to you, then God is no longer God. And you have annihilated, okay, the entire concept of sin. So I want you to understand again that sin is the choice of self as the supreme end. However, sin is the opposite of the supreme love of God. So sin is the choice that I am more important than God. You cannot get any more simple. What I've endeavored to do, what I'm attempting to do in this particular course, is to really try to keep things in a very simple way, in simple language that we can all comprehend, because it affords you the opportunity as well to be able to transmit the same concepts to other people in a language that they can understand. Essentially, we declare that I am the God of my life. It is a narcissistic idolatry. Narcissistic idolatry. Okay? And I want you to understand this. Okay? This is what sin is. It's narcissistic idolatry. This is what sin is. It's narcissistic idolatry. Not too long ago, as you know, I'm not technically oriented, right? But not too long ago, I was, in fact, several months back, which has only been maybe about, let's see, this is March, so yes, it'd be about 5 months more or less, I was introduced into the world of Facebook, right? Now, I know that a lot of you have laughed about that, because you find me to be very antiquated, and that is true, I won't deny any of that. But the thing that I noticed about Facebook is the narcissism. There's this inner desire. Have you ever seen these pictures that people post over and over? I mean, one person, you know, they get their camera out. And have you ever noticed these pictures? And in fact, and not too long ago, I posted one of a monkey, okay? With their lips protruding. And all you see these people is that there's this endless thing about taking pictures of self, right? And they always get up there, and it's always like something like this. There's always this thing, and they got this sultry look and so forth, you know? And it just, but there's no end to it. In fact, it's almost like every other day they're updating their picture. Now, they don't get rid of the other pictures. They just add to it. And if you plug into their little photo album, you'll see 50 pictures of themselves. Well, you know what? Men are the same way. I see guys, they're always putting a picture of themselves up. You know what this is called? And I know you're going to get upset at me, but I'm used to that. I'm used to that, okay? And that is this. This is what we call narcissistic idolatry. It's all about me. Sin is exactly that. It's narcissistic idolatry. This is exactly what it is. Second thing I want you to understand about this, let's make this be. Okay? And since we started on the concept of selfishness, okay, what we're going to say is that selfishness is at the root, okay, of all other, okay, forms of sin. I know that my handwriting is not the best. That's what happens after years of playing with the keyboard, right? I have to go back to practicing my letters. But look at this. Selfishness is at the root of all forms of sin. This is at the root of it. That's the reason why I start out with that. What is the basic nature of all sin? Sin is basically selfishness. And that's at the root of it. It's all about me. This is exactly how Satan, if you recall, was attempting to entice Jesus. Remember that in the book? We know the whole story, the book of Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 all the way down to verse 10. Remember that? To verse 11. That entire story. So what do we have at this? Well, selfishness is at the root of all forms of sin. What do we have? We have sensuality. We have pride, right? We have vanity. See, you begin to get a picture of this because you can understand these words. These words actually mean things now to us, okay? And all biblical terms for sin, I don't care what you call it, look, there's all kinds of categories of sin. But at the root of it is selfishness. You see, they have self as their ultimate reference point. See, the ultimate reference point for sin is you. It's self. You are the reference point. Now, I want you to think about that for a moment. If your reference point for morality is you, we're all in trouble. Because your reference point, if it's you, and remember we talked about that, the basic nature of all sin is selfishness, it's self. Okay? Then there is no objective standard to sin. It's like, at home, you're watching the news and it's kind of funny to hear my wife and my son talk about this because they go like, because I hear it and, we all kind of look at each other just dumbfounded when you hear the news and you hear the stupidity of what people do, but not only what they do, but it's allowed. It's actually allowed. Why? Because you see, you have to understand that the reference point is us. Fallen man is the reference point. God is not the reference point. Our own version of truth is the reference point. Truth itself is not the reference point. Are you beginning to get this picture? This is why the pulpit cannot afford to negotiate sin. You and I will always be at odds with the pew. Because we live in a world whose reference point is the world and whose reference point is always negotiable. Autonomous man is at the root of all forms of sin. You didn't see what I just said? Autonomous man is at the root of all sin. Now I want you to think about this word here, autonomous. Okay? Because autonomous, you have to understand, that means that I have no God. I am my own. Have you ever heard the expression, I am my own self-made man? I am self-made. Have you heard you've heard those expressions, right? That's an idiot speaking. Because his point of reference is him. I did this all on my own strength. Well, who gave you the strength? I did this with all my own brains. Well, who gave you the brains? I did this by myself. Well, who gave you the ability to breathe? Think about this for a moment with me. See, people don't think through most of what they say. So the autonomous man is at the root of all forms of sin. That's what that is. You have to understand it. Okay? What this is, it's the breakdown of the creator-creature distinction. Okay? So this is what we would call the breakdown. It's good. This is what we're going to call the breakdown, okay? Of the creator and creature distinction. You've heard me say it another way. See, God, we have God, creator. We have man, creature. This is the relationship, okay? He is infinite, we're finite. He is immortal, we're mortal. He is omniscient, right? He is omniscient, we require science. What is the word science? It's the word knowledge, right? See, he is all-knowing, and we have to come to know. So that's the relationship. But when you get into narcissistic idolatry, and you have now the breakdown of the creator and creature, this is exactly what happened, as I illustrate right here. This is it. There is no distinction. So man has lowered God in his own esteem, in his own eyes, and man has elevated himself. You cannot elevate yourself without lowering someone else. That's an act of impossibility. That's why we call this the breakdown of the creator and creature distinction. Selfishness itself cannot be predicted on or resolved into simpler elements. It just can't, because it involves and it engages so much of the self. I feel, I think, in my opinion, it engages so much of the will, the mind, the heart, and all of the emotional wrappings that come with it. What you can do is identify the elements of it, but to break it down to its nuances becomes very difficult, because usually when you get involved in narcissistic idolatry and you have the breakdown of the creator creature, now we have created a convoluted man. So let's begin to see if we can make this a little bit more simpler by looking at some examples. So let's take A, B, and let's do this. Let's make C over here, and we're going to make this as biblical examples. Okay? Let's do this way. Right? Let's do this as biblical examples. Now, I want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Isaiah. Okay? And let's go to Isaiah chapter 14, okay? Let's look at Isaiah chapter 14. We're going to look at verses 13 and 14, okay? Isaiah chapter 14, verses 13 and 14. Now, I'm reading out of the New American Standard Version of the Bible, which is what I'm teaching out of, okay? Now, I've been preaching for 34 years. I preached out of the King James Bible literally for 20 years. So that means for the last 14 years, I've been preaching and teaching out of the New American Standard Bible, because I spent 20 years correcting the King James. I never understood, and I've realized that, and that's because I've taken the time to study out the Hebrew and the Greek text. So I use that version because it just happens to have a better translation from the original languages. So, but you can use any version that you want, but I just want you to follow my text, okay? Just follow me as we go through. And let's look at four examples here. This is what I would like to do, looking at four examples with you, right? And let's look at, we know the story in the book of Isaiah, and we're going to go to Isaiah chapter 14. And we know this story very well, okay? This is where God has to now deal with, okay, Israel, and we have to deal with this issue of the fallenness of that is about to come and is about to take place. Mm-hmm. So let's just pick the story up in verse 13 and 14 as we begin to look at that. And what you have here in this story is going to be and here's what I want you to remember, this definition, because this is what we're going to work with right here. And I'm not erasing it because I have to come back to this. And here's what I want you to see right here. I want to show you five I wills. If you see, at the heart of sin is I, 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 I. Me, 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 me. I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. You know, it's like, you know, I was raised in a home with a very strict father. I'm not complaining. I mean, I didn't know anybody anyway. I mean, when you think about it, you know, when you become an adult and so forth, you know, and now as I'm approaching my retirement age, you know, that's and I think back to when I was being raised, I didn't know. It really didn't. I never really understood a lot of it. I just kind of accepted it. I was raised with a very strict father, but he was a man who had certain rules and had to be done in a certain way, and when he spoke, some things had to be spoken in a certain way, and so forth. So you asked the question, and let's say you raise your hand, you asked the question, and the question would be, you know, can I go to the bathroom? And my father was a man of few words, right? And he'd just look at you, and he was famous for his newspaper, right? You know, or if he didn't have the newspaper, okay, right here, he'd give you a cold cut right on the head. And so I remember he rolled up the newspaper and slap right on top of their head. I mean, you know what it is to get it whacked by the New York Post? Bam, on top of their head. I mean, and it wasn't some love tap. You know, my father isn't that, you know, touchy-touchy, warmy-warmy, feely-feely kind of guy, okay? And so he, bam, and I was just in a steady. I mean, I remember this very distinctly because tears came out of my eyes. And then he hit me again. Bam, men don't cry. I mean, now I'm really confused. But here's the point of my story. He said, wrong question. Now, I'm a child. I'm thinking in my head, no, you don't understand. I really need to go to the bathroom. You know, and I said, can I go? And he says, of course you can go. And I started to get up, and he hit me again. This is the third time. He said, you didn't ask me permission. And I'm thinking in my head, yes, I did. He says, no, you were supposed to say, may I go to the bathroom? Not if I can go. Big distinction. He says, I am sure you have the ability, son, to go to the bathroom, but you don't have the permission to do so. Man, talk about an object lesson. Now, I got hit in the head three times. Now, I want you to understand something. That stayed engraved in my head. Now, why do I share that? Because I need to take you now one step over. This is the difference between I can and I will. You know, we have the vernacular, the street vernacular, right? The street vernacular goes like this: you know, would have, could have, and should have, right? Would have, could have, and should have. There's always this hesitancy of what I should have done right, but I didn't do right. Now, in this passage of Isaiah chapter 14. Look at the declarations that are being made in verse 13 and 14 in relationship to the breakdown of the creature and of the creator and the creature distinction here. This is what I want you to see here, okay? So look at this in verse 13. Look what he says. He says, but you said in your heart, look at this. Now, I want to take you because this is when Lucifer gets thrown out, right? And let's pick this up in verse 12. How have you fallen from heaven, O star of the morning, son of the dawn? You have been cut down to the earth, and you have weakened the nations. Now notice this, right? So this is what we would call typically Satan's fall, right? Lucifer's fall from heaven, right? We know the story. In fact, it gets told, albeit very briefly, in the book of Luke. Okay, in the book of Luke in chapter 10, and then also in the book of Revelation in chapter 12. But nevertheless, here in Isaiah chapter 14, he tells us in verse 13. And now notice the reason why. Verse 13. But you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will. And I will sit on the mount assembly. I will. In the recesses of the Lord, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High God. And when I will, that's what this is at the heart of, okay? That is, the selfish is at the root of all forms of sin. This is what we call narcissistic idolatry. When Lucifer made the declaration, I will, I will, I will, I will, and I will, okay? He now blurred the break. This is now where we see, okay, the breakdown of the creature and the creator and the creature distinction. And once that takes place, you become the point of reference. Let's go to the book of Matthew, okay? Now let's take this in Matthew. And we're going to look at Matthew chapter 22, and let's look at verse 36 and 37. Matthew chapter 22, verse 36 and 37. Now, I want you to see this with me, okay? This is the great commandment, right? In fact, the other day I was on Sunday, after I finished preaching in the second service, we had one of our elders in the church, and he came to talk to me, and we were talking, and we were, you know, in a theological conversation, and which I always enjoy having with him. And in the middle of this conversation came up why much of the church today in many places around the world does not fulfill the Great Commission. The Great Commission. And I told him, I said, well, the problem is, I says, from my perspective, the reason why we don't fulfill the Great Commission is because we don't fulfill the Great Commandment. See, let me quote somebody for you. Some time ago, David Platt made a statement, and it stayed with me. And this was the statement. He said, how much do you have to hate someone not to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them? How much do you have to hate someone not to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them? How much do you have to hate them not to do that? Well, the failure of the Great Commission in the life of the church is because there's the failure of the Great Commandment. You cannot fulfill the Great Commission if you're not willing to live up to the Great Commandment. Right? And I want you to understand that. Okay? See why? Because the Great Commandment, let me write this. The Great Commandment I want you to understand this. The Great Commandment, right, opposes self-love. We are so in love with ourselves that the norm, because the point of reference is us. We're the point of reference. That's the reason why we will not fulfill the Great Commission. Because we don't live out the Great Commandment. And the Great Commandment opposes self-love. Look at what he says here in Matthew chapter 22. And look with me, starting in verse 36, 37. He says this. He says, teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? Here's the answer. And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. If I am loving God with all my heart, right? Because what he's saying, with all my soul, with all my mind, then there is no room for self-love. Self-love, okay, has to mean, by definition, I do not love God. Self-love, by definition, means I cannot love somebody else. I'm too in love with myself. Again, we go back to selfishness. When we ask the original question, what is the basic nature of all sin? Sin is basically selfishness. This is what Lucifer did, right? When he said, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. That's how he had enticed, how he had tempted Adam and Eve. Now, if you understand that, let's go to the book of Luke. Let's go to Luke chapter 12, and we're going to be looking at verses 13 to 21. Now, the only thing that we're doing here is that we're giving an overview so we begin to understand for what we had already been talking about in the last previous classes. So I want you to begin to see this as we begin to build up a head of steam here about understanding the doctrine of sin. I need you to see that with me. Now here, what I want you to understand is that the rich fool, here, because he's called a fool. See, the rich fool here chose self, okay, instead of who? Instead of God. This is exactly where we're at. Let me tell you, let me be very clear about that. There's a lot of rich fools and there's a lot of poor fools. There's just a lot of fools. When I choose me, I cannot choose God. There's no room for God in me. You cannot have it both ways. The Bible says it this way. You cannot serve mammon, money, and God at the same time. You will bow your knees to one toward the other. You will bow your knees either to money or you're going to bow your knees to God. And whoever you bow to is the one who's going to rule over you, because each one has his own rules, how you conduct yourself. Now in the book of Luke in chapter 12, look at this, starting in verse 13. Someone in the crowd said to him, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me. And he said to him, Man, who appointed me a judge or arbitrator over you? But he said to him, and he said to them, Beware and be on your guard against every form of greed. For not even one has an abundance does his life consist of his possessions. And he told them a parable, saying, The land of a rich man was very productive. And he began reasoning to himself, saying, What shall I do, since I have no place to store my crops? Then he said, This is what I will do. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. So he makes a decision, right? And I will say to my soul, watch this. Now you can see he's already going to fall into this trap. Up until this point, he really hasn't sinned. Now he's on the slippery slope toward that, but he hasn't done it. Now I want you to see this very carefully. It's because this is the subtlety of the deception. Look at this. It says here, then he said, This is what I will do. Remember the I will, I will, I will, I wills? Look at this. He says, And I will tear down my barns and the large ones, and I will store all my grains and my goods. You see this? And I will say to my soul, remember this? We get back to the I wills, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. You see this? Very clear. You can begin to see, you can see the pattern of this as it unfolds in Scripture. And he says, in verse 19, And I will say to my soul, Soul, you have many goods laid up for many years to come. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Right? This is what we call the Epicurean, right? The Epicurean mentality, right? Which means eat, drink, and be merry. Right? For who knows, for tomorrow we may die. You know, the Epicurean call is the one that the soldiers would have the night before they went to battle, because they knew that tomorrow they may die. So it was eat, drink, and be merry, right? And this is what you have. And this is the kind of mentality that you have, because you see no furtherance of something. Look what he says. And then God said to him, this is what God says to him in verse 20. God says, "You fool, this very night your soul is required of you. And now who will own what you have prepared?" God did not say, "Look here, fool, you can avoid all this if you just get right." No. He made the decision already. He had made the decision in the previous two verses, "I will, I will, I will, I will, and I will." And now God says, "You fool, your soul will be required tonight." He didn't say might be required tonight. You still have an opportunity. No, he says, because he had already determined. Why? Because the point of reference is self. He says, "You fool, this very night your soul is required of you. And now who will own what you have prepared? So is the man who stores up for treasure for himself and is not rich toward God." He chose self instead of God. This is exactly what happens in sin. Man chooses self. It's a choice. And with that choice now comes the consequences. You cannot evade the consequences. The consequences is part of the package. The only thing that you can hope for is God's grace and God's mercy. But the justice of God has to intervene at the point of choice. You have set the wheels into motion. The only thing that we can hope for is the grace of God and or the mercy of God, or both. In 2 Corinthians, I want you to see this with me. In 2 Corinthians, it's going to be chapter 5, and let's look at this in verse 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15. Now here is where Christ died so men would not have to live, see, so that men would not live for themselves, right? And that's the key. See, he's very clear. I mean, this doesn't get any more clear than this. I think sometimes what happens is that, and I've said this before in other classes that I've taught, I said the problem is that, see, everybody reads, but most people have never learned how to read. Most people actually study, but never learn how to study. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, look at this with me. Look at what it says here. And let's put this in its context, okay? Starting in verse 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and starting in verse 11, okay? And listen to what he says here. He says, "Therefore." Now, anytime you see the "therefore," we have a consequential statement. There is a statement of result. It's a statement of consequence. Now this, therefore, now this. You see, that word "therefore" becomes very important. When you see that word "therefore" and that comma, buckle up your seat. Because something is now about to be declared as a truth. You can either do one or two things with truth. Either you accept truth or you reject truth, but you cannot change the truth. So look at what he says here. He says, "Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest to God, and I hope that we are made manifest also in your consciences. We are not again commending ourselves to you, but are giving you an occasion to be proud of us, so that you will be have an answer for those who take pride in appearance and not in heart." For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. Right? Look what he's saying. In other words, if you think that I'm just outright just nutty, I'm insane, I'm crazy, you know, because, you know, all I do is eat, breathe, and sleep, you know, and talk about God, then I am. And Paul is making this statement because Paul spent all his time teaching and preaching the full counsel of the Word of God in addition to the gospel, right? And so Paul's made, because Paul is talking about the entire biblical concept of reconciliation, right? To be reconciled. He's urging. He's speaking to the heart of the Corinthians. And he says here, so if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are of sound mind, it is for you, right? If we're in sound mind, it's for you. So he says here very carefully here. Right? And so I want you to understand what he's talking about here. And he says, for the love of Christ controls us. Look at verse 14. Having concluded this, that one died for all, therefore all died. Period. He's made a declaration of fact. And he died for all. Look at verse 15. And he died for all. This doesn't get any more clear than this, okay? He says he died for all. So that they who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. So Paul is communicating to them that this idea, this whole concept of this self-centered life was finished, and that he had an all-out desire to live righteously. See, that's what we're talking about here. Okay? I am no longer self-righteous, I'm no longer self-this, no longer self-that. It's not about me, and I get hit with an attack of the me-me's here, okay? It's not about I. We're talking about that. He says, you no longer live for yourselves. That's exactly what he says here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15. And he says it this way. He says that you no longer, so that they who live might no longer live for themselves. You no longer live for yourself, okay? No longer live for self. You begin to get this picture of this idea, okay, that we're talking about here of sin. We have to be very clear about what we're talking about, but we have to be able to speak about it in terms that are simple enough for people to grasp. And the reason why I'm not speaking to their intelligence. That's not what I'm talking about. So please don't misunderstand me. Not at all. What I am addressing here is that their point of reference is self. And because your point of reference is self, your standard is extremely vague. And it is a moving target. Your standard is changing. It's pretty shaky, okay? Because it's wrapped up in self. And self is emotional. Much of what self does is based on feelings, emotions. That's what makes this so difficult. When you have a conversation with somebody about sin, they just look at you like you're stupid, like you're an idiot, like you're some self-righteous nutball. And the reason why is because you have to understand that self, the point of reference for everything that person is listening to, is self. They have Dr. Gary Fleetwood, I like the phrase he uses. He has this phrase that I like, and he says that everybody has a grid. There's this grid, okay? There is this grid, right? And this grit that we all see things. So we have a point. We have a point of reference. Have you watched the news? Have you watched? And what I'm talking about here in the United States, in our country, a lot of times, my family and I, my wife and my son will be looking at the news, and we just stand there looking at each other like, these people are crazy. Well, it's because either we have two main political parties in our country. Now, there's some other ones, but the two main ones is the Republican Party and the Democratic Party. But if you listen to both of them, right? The grid is either you're a Democrat or you're a Republican. So when they speak, now, we're standing on the outside. We're home looking at the TV screen, and we could see it. Okay? And you can see the grid that they're speaking through. It doesn't matter what truth is. It doesn't matter what they have to say at all. They just see things through their grid, through their political grid. They see it only through the Republican grid. The other one sees it only through the Democratic grid. Okay? Well, this is, and so when they speak, okay, and you say something, and a lot of times we'll watch one of the talk shows, right? And they'll, and what they do is that the interviewer will ask the question, and then the interviewer is absolutely in a state of shock when he hears the answer from them, he or she. It's like, it doesn't make sense. And you can actually see the facial contortions of the interviewer, right? Because he or she is in a state of unbelief. Did you actually just give me that answer? Well, the reason is because they have this grit. And this is what Dr. Fleetwood always talks about. Well, you and I, we have a theological grit. All of us. All of us have a doctrine. Now, we may not call it a doctrine, but we do. We all see things through a certain grid. It's like my glasses here, right? Okay? My glasses become my filter, okay, of how I see everything, right? And so all of us have this grid that we see things through. I want you to understand that. And this is exactly what happens when you get to the point of self. When self becomes the point of reference. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? Is that you only see things through self. You can't see the other side. You're seeing everything through self. But what would happen if all of a sudden you could see self from the other direction? You would not like what you see. So what happens is that we only see things through self. And when you are the point of reference, okay, this is exactly why you could speak to somebody and they just look at you like you're just nuts. Like, what's the problem? I understand. And you hear things like this. Well, it's my life. It's my future. It's my body. Are you hearing the I wills in it? Are you hearing the self? See, and what you have here is this narcissistic idolatry taking place here. This is the reason why. The basic nature of all sin is basically selfishness. And self, many times, cannot either accept, recognize, acknowledge that there are real consequences to self. They just see it as the freedom and the ability to choose, but to do so without consequences. And that's the problem with this issue of sin. So at first, you talk to somebody, that's the reason why you can have somebody visit your church service week after week, and they just sit there, and they're almost impenetrable. You're sharing the gospel and you're praying on the inside, Lord, touch that person. But right now, their point of reference is only self. And they have this point of view, this I'm okay, you're okay. No, you're not okay. You have no idea about what's going to happen to you. You have no clue because you are the point of reference. This is the challenge that you and I face. In 2 Corinthians in chapter 5, it says, who live no longer for themselves. So now let's ask this other question. Let's do this here. Let's begin to ask this other question here. Okay? Because we have to really break it down. We have to break this down to its components, to the basic elements. Okay? We have to, right? Because it's the only way that you can actually, you have to really break it down so that people understand what you're talking about. So here's what, so we're going to ask this question. What is sin's ultimate, what is sin's ultimate source? That's the question. What is sin's ultimate source? Okay? It's got to come from somewhere. Sin didn't just pop up in the universe as some rebel molecule that broke away and then on its own it developed into something else. I understand the Big Bang Theory, and I understand all those things that people talk about. So I want you to understand that, right? So sin, what is sin's ultimate source? Sin in the universe, okay? So let's put this. Sin in the universe originated with Satan. Yep, with that guy. It originated with Satan. In fact, if you were to speak to the average sinner, I have no idea what an average sinner is. I mean, I'm just trying to find a way to express it, okay? Because that will presuppose that I know what a real bad sinner is, and a high class sinner, a lower class sinner. I have no idea. But if you were to speak to the average person who's a sinner, and we're all sin, right? And you asked them, and you said to them, you know what? You are Satan. They would be so insulted, so angry with you, okay? Because they don't even recognize that their sin nature, its origination comes from Satan. They don't even know what the source is of who they are and what they do. They don't even get that picture. So you have to kind of break things down for them. Go to 1 John. Let's go to 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. Let's look at this. Look what he says. He says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 8, he says, the one who practices sin is of Disneyland. Isn't that what it says? No. He says, the one who practices sin is of the devil. For the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. So immediately, John, the apostle, sets up a clear contrast for us. Very clear. That either you're from God or you're from the devil. You got it. See, there is no in between. But where the average sinner, and as I said again, I don't even know what an average sinner is, okay? But where the average person who's gotten lost in this is that, see, they can't even conceive of the notion that they might be, okay, in one camp or the other. See, they don't see. They don't see this. They don't see in God's camp, and they don't see the devil's camp. You know what they see? They see self. They cannot conceive. They don't see themselves here, and they don't see themselves here. They see themselves here. So as far as they're concerned, this is where you get the whole idea about, I'm okay, you're okay. It's not so bad. Well, everybody's doing it. Everybody does it. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? And when you press them, when you press them a little bit harder, okay? And so what camp do they think they find themselves in? It's amazing to me, and I do this in airplanes a lot because, you know, I mean, think about it. Where are they going, right? You know, and it's not like they're going to open the window and leave. They can't open the door and leave, right? They're going to meet Jesus real fast. So we're having a conversation, right? And it's, you know, what amazes me is that, let me be honest with you, I never start the conversation. I don't have to. Now, I will admit, I provoke it. Yes, I do. I'm not gonna lie to you about that. I do provoke it because the only thing I have to do is, hey, when I get seated, the first thing I do is take out my Bible, take out my book, okay? I'm gonna read, I'm gonna cross-reference, okay? Or I'm gonna take out my teaching notes, okay? And the person next to me, it's inevitable because they're gonna sit there and they're gonna look over to see what I'm looking at. And it doesn't take long for the conversation to start. It does not take long for the conversation to start. And inevitably we'll get around to this issue. Well, what do you do? I says, I work as part of a team of solving the issue and the problem of sin. And they're like, what? And you get into the conversation with them, right? And what happens is that when you ask them about this right here, right? They're neither here nor there, or they're semi-quasi, which I don't even understand what that is, okay? But they're clearly in self. They're clearly in self. This is the reason why, okay? You have to have, okay, a very clear understanding of where people are in their heads. Because he said it very clearly in the book of 1 John chapter 3, right? In 1 John chapter 3, and I was quoting it from memory, but let me make sure I get it right. He says, the one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose to destroy the works of he says, the works of the devil. Then he says, no one who is born of God, remember the whole notion of being born again? He says, practice his sin because his seed abides in him. And he cannot sin because he is born of God. Do you see that? So here he's talking about, he's not talking about that it's impossible to sin if you're born of God. Of course you're going to sin. Let me tell you, he's talking about you do not habitually, purposely go out to sin. But you and I are going to sin because we're part of this world here. We still live here. Okay? So he says here, he says, no one who is part of God practices sin in verse 9 because his seed abides in him and he cannot sin because he is born of God. And by this, in verse 10, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. It's obvious. Do you see that? It's obvious. I'm not that intelligent, but I can tell you something, okay? That I'm not that stupid either. The Bible says that it is obvious. Verse 10, right? He said the children of God and the children of the devil is obvious, right? Isn't that what it says? What he's saying is that, listen, either you're here or you're here. And it's obvious. But when you speak to the sinner, remember what I said earlier, the average sinner, whatever that means, okay? His point of reference is self, so he's here. He doesn't see this, but it is obvious. Why? Because his point of reference is himself. And he says, by this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God, for the one who does not love his brother. So when I'm on the plane talking to somebody, and I go, okay, well, let me ask you this question. Do you practice righteousness? And that's when they get all twisted. My brother-in-law loves to use that phrase. I quote him all the time. He says, and that's when they get all twisted. They go, what? Righteousness? I said, so then you do practice sin.